Currently, we are discussing diseases due to protozoal infections, and the topic for today is amoebiasis, which is caused by infection due to entamoeba histolytica or tissue lysing amoeba. This is quite a common infection and may present with a virulent intestinal commensal or may lead to disease, which may be severe and serious or even sometimes life-threatening. It's quite a common disease, but previous estimates that up to about 10% of the whole world population is infected are wrong, and it's probably due to inability to differentiate this amoeba from other non-pathogenic amoeba, which are normal commensals in the human intestine, notably Entamoeba dispar and Entamoeba mishkoskii. Because these amoeba are non-pathogenic, but they are morphologically identical to Entamoeba histolytica, and it's impossible to differentiate between them except by using molecular techniques. So with the advent of current technology, we are able to differentiate, and we know that most of these infections due to non-pathogenic amoeba were confused by Entamoeba histolytica. However, it's quite a common infection, and most of the infections are asymptomatic. The amoeba exists in two forms, a hardy multinucleated cyst form, which is the inactive form, and the motile trophozoite, which is the active and pathogenic form. Infection is acquired by fecal-oral route by ingestion of contaminated food and water, and cysts are the infectious form. Because cysts are tough and they can resist outside environment, and they can also tolerate the gastric acidity. However, the trophozoite form cannot survive for long outside the body, and it cannot tolerate the gastric acidity as well. Poor sanitation and crowding are important risk factors. That's why this disease is prevalent in the rural areas of underdeveloped countries. This is the picture of Entamoeba cyst, and this is an active Entamoeba histolytica trophozoite with ingested red blood cells inside it, which means active infection. The disease is endemic in most of the tropical and subtropical regions of the world, notably parts of Mexico, India, and countries in the tropical regions of Africa, South and Central America, and rest of the Asia. In Western countries, the disease usually occurs only in travelers who have visited to the endemic areas, or in institutionalized persons where short outbreaks can occur. The disease pathogenesis is caused by penetration of the intestinal wall by the pathogen, which results in diarrhea, and with severe involvement, it can lead to dysentery, which means diarrhea with bloody stools and fever, or sometimes extra-intestinal disease, the most common form of which is the amoebic liver abscess. The pathogen contains several virulence factors which make it possible to destroy the tissues, enter the tissue, cause inflammation, and to evade host responses, immune responses. First of all, the mucinous barrier of the colon is lost, so that the amoeba comes direct in contact with the epithelium. There are several mechanisms by which it can induce necrosis or apoptosis in the epithelial cells and enter the epithelial to reach the subepithelium. And there, in the submucosa, it can spread laterally to make the characteristic flask-shaped ulcers with a broad base and narrow neck. The infection usually stops at the muscularis layer. It cannot penetrate the muscle, so that the full thickness ulcers and perforation are very uncommon. This is the pathology of ulcer, the characteristic flask-shaped ulcers with narrow neck and broad base, and it stops at the muscularis layer, and active amoeba can usually be found at the interface between necrotic and live tissues. And there is a lot of necrotic tissue inside the ulcer. This is the gross pathology, a specimen of the disease. You can see multiple ulcers in the colon, while the intervening mucosa is usually normal. There is no inflammation in between. The most common symptoms when the disease is actually symptomatic are gradual onset of lower abdominal pain and diarrhea. Fever is uncommon, and usually without treatment, the disease becomes chronic, and it is associated with periods of remission and recurrence. Patient may improve himself and then to have recurrence of symptoms after some time, and this continues for days or several weeks. Less commonly presents with more severe disease, with dysentery and more extensive diarrhea of up to 10 to 20 stools per day, bloody stools, high fevers, prostration, vomiting, abdominal pain and tenderness, and hepatic enlargement, hypotension. This is a serious condition, and rarely patient can present the most serious fulminant amoebic colitis, very rare condition, where it can lead to necrotizing colitis, intestinal perforation, mucosal sloughing, and severe hemorrhage. This condition, although rare, but carries a mortality of about 40%. Certain acute and chronic complications can occur without proper treatment of the disease. Among the acute complications are toxic megacolon, and this is a serious complication and occurs in the case of fulminant amoebic colitis we have just discussed. And sometimes the disease can present with extra-intestinal disease, most common form of which is the liver abscess. While chronic complications, a patient can present with chronic diarrhea, with weight loss, like a malabsorption type of picture, sometimes with extensive bowel ulceration, which can resemble inflammatory bowel disease, and even sometimes with amoebic appendicitis. Amoeboma, which is an inflammatory mass which protrudes into the bowel lumen and can cause obstructive symptoms, is another chronic complication. Hepatic abscess, as already mentioned, is the most common extra-intestinal manifestation of the disease. It can occur with the symptoms of colitis, but more frequently there are no prior symptoms of intestinal disease. And indeed, it has been found that about 20% of patients only give any history of diarrhea or abdominal pain, so that the pathogen directly invades the mucosa, enters the portal circulation, reaches the liver and causes disease there to form the liver abscess. Most of the other symptoms, other patients who don't report any intestinal symptoms also don't excrete any active trophocytes also. The disease is quite serious if not treated promptly, because it can lead to certain complications which are serious. And indeed, only about 100 years before, this was a uniformly lethal disease. But now, with modern management, the mortality is around 1%. This is not only due to the presence of proper treatment, but also diagnostic modalities which lead to early detection of disease and cause proper treatment. The patient usually presents with the abdominal pain, fever, and enlarged and tender liver, anorexia, and weight loss. Physical examination will show right hypochondrial tenderness and sometimes intercostal tenderness also. Without prompt treatment, amoebic abscess may rupture into pleural, peritoneal, or pericardial space. The last condition is often fatal. Sometimes patients present dramatically with the hepatobronchial fistula, in which patients develop sudden cough with the expectoration of copious amount of brownish content, which is actually the content of the abscess, which is mean expectorated. So these are serious complications, and patients should be diagnosed and treated before any complication has occurred. Otherwise, the prognosis becomes more poor. Rarely, abscesses can occur in other organs like brain and lung. The diagnosis of amoebiasis mainly depends upon identifying the organism in the stool. Serological assays are also sensitive, but they may be negative early in the disease because it takes some time to develop antibodies, but they are also less specific as well. Detection of entamoeba antigen in the fresh stool sample is also another reliable test, and it gives early results and easier to perform also. However, the most reliable test is examination of fresh ulcer exudates to find motile trophozytes or its antigen in that exudate. Diagnosis of the liver abscess depends upon imaging studies, either by ultrasound or CT abdomen, which show a characteristic filling defect, along with positive serological tests in the blood. Sometimes percutaneous aspiration of abscess may be required, but detection of organism is quite uncommon, and it's actually the appearance of the content like anchovy paste which is more characteristic and diagnostic. This is a CT scan showing a large amoebic liver abscess with surrounding edema, and this is the appearance of anchovy paste. The contents of the amoebic liver abscess actually look like this, dark brownish. Treatments is usually requires two-step treatment. First of all, eradication of the tissue trophozytes which are causing the pathology. This treatment is by either metronidazole 750 mg orally 3 times daily for 10 days or 500 mg intravenously 3 times daily also for 10 days. It should be noted that oral treatment is equally effective for amoebic liver abscess, but if the patient is actively vomiting and very sick and unable to take oral drugs, then intravenous drug is preferable. After treatment, treatment with aluminal amoebicide is also required to eradicate the intestinal cysts, because these drugs which have, we have just mentioned cannot eradicate the luminal cysts, which remain a source of infection to the patient and to the other people as well. So three drugs are available to eradicate the inactive cysts in the intestine. These are deloxynite furoate 500 mg 3 times daily, iodoconazole 650 mg 3 times daily, or peromomycin 1 gram 3 times daily, about for 7 to 10 days. Sometimes in serious disease, replacement of fluid and electrolytes where severe diarrhea or vomiting are there, and the need for antipyretics if the patient is febrile. Now we will discuss some rare diseases due to free living amoeba. As we have mentioned that active amoeba and amoeba cannot survive for long outside the human body, so it is a pathogen. Only the cyst forms can survive outside the body. But there are certain free living amoeba which can sometimes cause disease in humans. The most important of them is Nigleria species, especially Nigleria fowleri, which is also called brain eating amoeba. This is an agent of primary amoebic meningoencephalitis, a very serious condition which rapidly leads to death with very few survivals of this condition. This infection is usually acquired while swimming in a fresh water, where the amoeba can enter the nose by splashes of water, can invade through the nasal mucosa, through the cribriform plate, and reach the brain, where which can cause acute meningoencephalitis. Presents initially with anosmia or loss of taste sensation, then presents with headache, fever, photophobia, nausea, and vomiting. Then rapidly signs of cranial nerve palsies appear, seizures which progress to coma and ultimately death. Unfortunately, few reliable treatments are available, and some anecdotal reports of efficacy of intravenous amphotericin B in association with rifampicin with some effective results have been reported, but none are currently recommended as standard treatments. Another one is acanthamoeba. This agent causes two syndromes, a granulomatous amoebic encephalitis and sometimes a type of keratitis. This condition usually occurs in debilitated, chronically ill, and immunosuppressed individuals. For example, those who are suffering from lymphoproliferative disorders and are on chemotherapy, or patients who are on glucocorticoids, diabetics, or those who are infected with HIV. It causes granulomatous amoebic encephalitis, and it is bloodborne. That is, it is not acquired through the nose, but it is acquired through the skin, penetration of the amoeba through some ulcer, travels through the skin and goes to the brain. It causes chronic granulomatous amoebic encephalitis, which is a gradually progressive disease and presents like an space-occupying lesion with focal signs like hemiplegia, cranial nerve palsies, ataxia, and gradually the condition progresses to seizures, coma, and ultimately death. It also don't have some very reliable treatments, but some reports of antifungals like flucytosine in combination with rifampicin have been found to be efficacious. A third one is Balamuthia mandrillaris. This is also an agent of meningococcal encephalitis. Indeed, it causes a disease very similar to that of acanthamoeba, but this pathogen can cause disease in immunocompetent as well as immunocompromised patients. However, it is more common at the extremes of ages, for example, young children or elderly or pregnant ladies or patients who are on glucocorticoid therapy. But it can also cause disease in otherwise healthy people and presents similarly as granulomatous amoebic encephalitis like acanthamoeba, and the treatment is also the same. In this picture, you can see an active amoeba, nigelleria, inside the brain tissue, and this is a cyst of acanthamoeba inside the brain tissue. Of course, both of these are brain biopsy specimens. The next disease is giardiasis, which is also a very common protozoal infection of the upper small intestine caused by Giardia lamblia. One of the most common parasitic diseases in the developed as well as developing countries worldwide. But this infection is most of the common. It is asymptomatic and commonly occurs in areas with poor sanitation. The organism is excreted in stool as an active trophozoite and as the cyst form. But likewise, the cysts are the infectious stages, because they can resist weather conditions as well as can tolerate gastric acidity, and is spread by contaminated water and food. And it's highly infectious disease, and a small dose of as few as 10 cysts can cause infection in a human. After the cysts are ingested, the trophozoites emerge in the duodenum and jejunum and multiply by binary fission. When the conditions are altered and unsuitable for division, then it acquires the shape of cysts, which are then excreted in the stool and become infectious to other people. And the cysts are not destroyed by routine culinary. This is an important point in prevention of the disease, that it is not destroyed by routine chlorination, which can get rid of most of other infections. And eradication of this in the water supplies requires either boiling or filtration with a filter of appropriate pore size. Both of these conditions are quite, processes are quite costly, so that this makes prevention of the disease quite difficult and costly. The mechanism by which Giardia causes alteration in bowel function are largely unknown, because no specific pathology has been found. And it's been found that in symptomatic infections also, epithelial damage and invasion is not seen, and the morphology of the bowel is unaltered. So it is thought that large number of pathogens can cover the surface of the absorptive cover surface of the intestine, so that leading to a malabsorption type of condition. However, in chronically infected symptomatic patients, the histologic findings resembling those of tropical sprue or gluten-sensitive enteropathy can occur, which consists of flattening or total loss of villi without any inflammatory component. Almost 50% of these infections are asymptomatic. 10% of these become asymptomatic cyst passers, because they are themselves asymptomatic, but they are a source of infection to others. And about 25% present with an acute diarrheal illness, which is usually self-limited. The diarrhea can be watery and profuse, and can sometimes be so severe that to require hospitalization. Some patients present with chronic disease with abdominal cramps, bloating, flatulence, nausea, malaise, and anorexia. Fever and vomiting are uncommon. The stools are greasy and frothy and foul smelling without blood pus or mucus. So it gives a picture of malabsorption, but there is no evidence of inflammatory component, because there is no blood, pus or mucus in these stools. This chronic disease can lead to malabsorption of fat and protein and vitamin deficiencies. And this can cause weight loss and growth retardation, especially in children who are already undernourished. This is a diagram of a picture of an active flagellated binucleate Giardia trophozoite, which is binucleated and contains four pairs of flagella. The diagnosis is made by identification of either trophozoite or cyst in the stool. A wet mount of liquid stool is required to identify active motile trophozoites. Otherwise, stained fixed specimens may also show the cysts or trophozoites. But the disease is difficult to diagnose because cyst excretion is variable and sometimes may be undetectable, so that repeated sampling may be required. Detection of stool Giardia antigen by strip test or CAR test in the stools is at least as sensitive and specific as microscopic examination and is easier to perform and gives rapid results. But all these methods may yield false negative results, so that sometimes upper GI endoscopy is required with duodenal aspirate and biopsy examination. Treatment is by either metronidazole 250 mg orally 3 times daily for 5 to 7 days or tinidazole as a 2 gram single oral dose. An alternative is nitazoxanide 500 mg twice daily for 3 days. Prevention is by personal hygiene, boiling of water for at least 1 minute or water filtration with appropriate filter size. While chlorination of water is ineffective and does not prevent from the disease. The next disease is trichomoniasis. This is caused by protozoan Trichomonas vaginalis and is also quite common. It is among the most common sexually transmitted diseases because it is spread by sexual contact. This causes vaginitis in women and non-gonococcal urethritis in men. This infection is also frequently asymptomatic, but in symptomatic women presents with vaginal discharge, often with vulvovaginal discomfort, pruritus, and abdominal pain. Symptomatic infection in men presents with urethritis, with dysuria, and scanty discharge. The local examination shows a copious discharge in the vagina, which is not foul smelling, but is often frothy and yellow to green in color. There are inflammation of the vaginal wall and cervix with punctate hemorrhages, and examination of a wet mouth of the discharge will show motile organisms. Antigen detection tests and nucleic acid amplification assays are more sensitive and specific and are now available. The treatment is by tinidazole or metronidazole, each as a 2 gram single oral dose, or alternatively metronidazole in a dose of 500 mg twice daily for 1 week. With this, we complete our topic of protozoal infections, and in the next lecture, we will discuss infections due to helminths, and that will be our last lecture in association with infectious diseases. Thank you very much.